search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, the treasures that fade, never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. We say there is nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Not afraid.
I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all. You still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. And there's not a place that your mercy and grace won't find me again.
You turn graves into Hello, Calvary Phoenix, and welcome to Sanctuary. I'm Pastor Brian Fergus, and I'm glad that you've joined us for this time of worship and study. We just experienced some worship, and now we're going to spend some time digging in to God's Word. I really hope you enjoyed last week's worship and communion service. We just took a break from our normal routine to dive deep into our devotion to the Lord by worshiping together and having a virtual communion service. It was a special time. I hope you got to participate in that. We're starting a new study today. And before we do, let's pray, and then we'll just jump right in. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ who are joining me in this study. I pray that as we talk about these issues and verses of scripture that we're going to be picking apart together, that you would give us wisdom and insight, and that this time would encourage us and strengthen us in our faith. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So like I said, today we're starting a two-week study, and we're calling it Old Testament Promises for New Testament Believers. Now, this might seem like a very random topic to be picking up right now, considering everything that's going on in our world, right? We are still dealing with the effects of a global pandemic. Here in Arizona, we're dealing with the hottest summer on record. Not a fan of 2020 because of that alone. We are also dealing with wildfires. There's a lot happening in our world. And so talking about something as maybe obtuse as Old Testament promises for New Testament believers might seem a bit tone deaf given everything that's going on right now. But it's actually pretty important. My hope with this little two-part study is to clear up some confusion that I've been noticing as I talk to my friends on the phone or as I see folks in our churches on social media. There's some confusion out there that I'm hoping to clear up. In fact, I think everything that's going on in the world, all the rough stuff right now, is contributing to this confusion, especially the pandemic. And here's the confusion. Let me just lay it down and then we'll talk about it for a while today. I think people often see promises that God made in the Old Testament, and they wonder why he isn't fulfilling those promises for believers today. Let me give you a very specific example. Grab your Bibles and open them to the book of Deuteronomy. Now, that's probably a book you don't go to very often in your devotional life. But Deuteronomy is an important book. In fact, it's one of the books that Jesus quotes from the most. So Deuteronomy chapter 28 contains some promises that can be fairly confusing for New Testament believers. Let's take a look at it. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1, this is the Lord speaking through Moses. And he says this, "And if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground and the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your herds and the young of your flock. Blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out." Now these verses right here tell us that if we follow God's commands, he will bless us materially, right? That's what that passage is about. If you obey God's commands, he's going to bless the fruit of your womb. He's going to give you lots of healthy kids. He's going to bless your crops. He's going to bless the fruit of your cattle. That means you're going to have lots more cows. This is a promise for material blessing based upon our obedience. And some people wonder, why isn't God keeping that promise to believers today? Because frankly, some of the most faithful and obedient followers of Jesus that I personally know are materially poor. I've been to Uganda. I've seen pastors with little huts with dirt floors that they're living in, with large families. I've done ministry in Thailand to Laotian pastors who've crossed over to participate in our ministry, who some of whom don't even have Bibles themselves, just parts of Bibles. If material blessing is a sign of faithfulness and obedience, what's going on? Why aren't these faithful followers of Jesus being materially blessed? One of two options. Either God is just flat out lying to us in Deuteronomy chapter 28, or we need some clarity. Maybe we've misunderstood something. Now, listen, God's not lying to us. He can't and he won't. But we do need to clarify some things. And in fact, I'm hoping the conversations that we're going to have over the next 2 weeks, you know, today and then next Wednesday, I'm hoping that these conversations will bring some clarity to this issue, because there's a lot of bad things happening out there, and we wonder, why is God allowing this? Why isn't he fixing it? He promises us material abundance, and no matter what, as long as we're faithful and obedient, and we're doing our best to be faithful and obedient, and yet still, these things are happening. I want us to answer that question, clarify some issues. Today, we'll lay some groundwork, a framework, if you will, that will serve us well next week. And, you know, just a heads up, these lessons are going to feel more like conversations than sermons, really, because I just want to talk to you. And so the first place I want us to go, you know, keep a finger in Deuteronomy 28, because we'll be back. But the first place that I want us to go is Genesis chapter 12. And I'm going to show you what I think are the most important verses in the Bible. And believe it or not, they're in Genesis chapter 12. So turn there with me in your copy of the scriptures to Genesis chapter 12. And we're going to step into a conversation that God is having with Abraham, the patriarch of our faith. He's called Abram at this point. God hasn't quite changed his name, so we'll make sure we read it correctly, but we'll just call him Abraham. Genesis 12, 1 through 3, and I'm not kidding on this. I think these are about the most important verses of the Bible. Says this. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Most important verses in the Bible. If you'll hang with me, I'll help you understand why. And I guarantee if you hang with me, the whole Bible will make a whole lot more sense to you by the time we're done today. Why do I call these verses the most important verses in the Bible? Pretty simple. Because Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, really unlocks the whole Bible. These verses, these three verses, actually serve as the outline of the entire Bible from this point on. Genesis 1 through 11, you kind of look at as the prologue of the Bible. It helps us understand who we are, why we're here. It answers those big questions. But then the story of the Bible begins in Genesis 12, 1, and then, of course, goes through the end of Revelation. And what we've just read in Genesis 12, verses 1 through 3, is a description of God's covenant with Abraham. I need to do a sidebar on covenants real quick, because maybe that's a concept that you're not terribly familiar with. You need to know that the Bible is all about covenants. That's why it's arranged the way it is. That's why it contains the contents that it does. And let me just define covenants for you in a very understandable way. Covenants are basically just special relationships with God. That's all they are. And there are a handful of covenants in Scripture, five solid covenants, really. And they all have some important elements in common. Every covenant contains these three elements, parties, and those are the people who are involved in the covenant. The terms, these are the details of the covenant itself, the special arrangement, the agreement, if you will. And every covenant contains promises, and these are the consequences, both positive and negative, to either keeping or breaking the covenant. Think about it kind of like a contract, right? You go, you buy a new car. The parties involved in that transaction are you and the car dealership. The terms of that transaction are you pay so much a month for so long, and the car is yours. You can use it in the meantime even. How about that? The promises of that covenant are that if you keep your end of the bargain and pay your monthly payments on time, at the end of it, they'll give you the title, car is yours. Also, they promise that if you don't keep your end of it, don't make your payments on time, they come and take that car from you, right? It's a contract. And so every Old Testament covenant, every New Testament covenant contains these three elements: parties, the people involved, terms, that's the details of the covenant, and promises. Those are the consequences to either keeping or breaking the covenant. Now, there's five big covenants in the Bible that I mentioned that just a moment ago, and let me lay them out very, very quickly. Won't go into detail on all of them because we're going to dig into a few of them here in just a moment. But there's a covenant we call the Noahic covenant, and that's the covenant God made with Noah, the rainbow, all that stuff. You remember that that story. There's the Abrahamic covenant. We just read God established the Abrahamic covenant there in Genesis 12, 1 through 3. There's the Mosaic covenant that will come later in the life of God's people as he lays down the law so that they know how to live well in the land. There's the Davidic covenant that God makes with David and promises that somebody from his family will rule God's people forever. And of course, we know that ultimately that's Jesus, right? A descendant of David. And then finally, the New Testament talks quite a bit about the new covenant. That's the covenant that you and I enjoy as believers in Jesus, all right? So, end of sidebar. Let's go back to this passage in Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, and let's talk about the Abrahamic covenant for just a moment. Let's run our grid and understand who the parties are, what the terms are, and what the promises are in this covenant. First of all, the parties in this covenant are God and Abraham, right? God is establishing a relationship with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. But the thing about this is some of these promises and parts of this agreement extend beyond Abraham. And so Abraham is really representing his family. He serves as his family's representative. The terms of this covenant are that Abraham is to believe God and trust him, and he's to demonstrate that trust and belief by moving from Ur of Chaldees, that's where he lived right at the time, the safest, biggest city on the planet. He's supposed to move from there and go to the land of Canaan. And so he's called to demonstrate his trust in God by moving to Canaan. Those are the terms. The promises are pretty amazing. God promises Abraham that if he enters this covenant and does those things, God will bless Abraham's faithfulness by giving him his own homeland, by giving him a big family, and by giving him the privilege of being a blessing to all of humanity. All right? Those are the parties and terms and promises of the Abrahamic covenant. Let's go back to Genesis 12, 1 through 3. One more time, we'll just work through it. There's a reason for this. You got to hang with me. We'll work through these three verses very quickly, and you'll see all of these elements that we just said. So now the Lord said to Abram, so there's our parties right away, the Lord and Abraham. Here are the terms. Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. That's what he's supposed to do. Those are the terms of the agreement. He's supposed to demonstrate trust in God by going. And here come the promises. He's mentioned land there in verse 1. So that's one of the promises, a homeland. And here's the rest of the promises. And I will make you a great nation. and I will bless you and I will make your name great. There's the big family. I will make you a great nation, big family, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And there's that third promise. He's going to be a blessing to the nations. If Abraham agrees to this covenant, God is going to bless him with a homeland, a big family, and the opportunity to be a blessing to the nations. And now, hear me on this. The rest of the Bible is the story of God keeping these three promises to this one man. I'm not kidding. This is the outline for the Bible. In Genesis chapter 12, from verse 4 through the end of chapter 50, God is fulfilling his promise to give Abraham a big family. And he does that. In fact, when we open up the book of Exodus, we see that Abraham's family numbers in the millions at that point. It's amazing how God keeps that promise. Then Exodus chapter 1 through the end of the book of Malachi is all about God fulfilling his promise to give Abraham's family a homeland and to help them know how to live well in that homeland. That's the whole Old Testament. From Exodus 1 through the end of Malachi 4, this is all about God keeping that promise to give Abraham's family a homeland and helping them understand how to best live in that homeland. And then, of course, the entire New Testament, Matthew 1 through Revelation 23, is about God blessing the whole world through Abraham's offspring. Of course, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, and by extension, us, his followers, as we represent him. So you'll see why I call this the most important passage in the Bible. It really sets out the outline for the entire passage of Scripture. Now, this series is called Old Testament Promises and New Testament Believers. And I've just told you that God has established a covenant with Abraham that he fulfills in the first part of Genesis with, you know, establishing him in a big family. The second part of these promises, the promise to give Abraham a homeland, is dealt with in Exodus through Malachi. And if you're a student of the Old Testament, or if you've just casually read it, you know that the book of Exodus establishes another special agreement between God and his people, the nation of Israel. And we call that special agreement the Mosaic Covenant. We call it the Mosaic Covenant because Moses is the one who facilitates that between God and the people of Israel. And so I want to spend a little bit of time now talking to you about the Mosaic Covenant, and you'll see why. Because it's our misunderstanding of this covenant that actually creates a lot of the confusion that we were just talking about a moment ago. Why isn't God keeping some of these promises? Deuteronomy 28, why isn't he keeping these promises to us? So let's talk about the Mosaic Covenant. Let's talk about the parties involved. Remember, every covenant has these three pieces. The parties involved in the Mosaic Covenant are, of course, God and Moses, but not just Moses. Moses is representing the nation of Israel, right? And so those are the parties in this covenant. The terms of this covenant are, these folks are supposed to keep the law. Moses records 613 laws that God gives them, and these folks are supposed to demonstrate their faith in the Lord, their trust in God by living according to his law. They're not living according to his law to be saved. The law doesn't save people. It's just the way that God calls them to demonstrate their faith, right? God said, Abraham, move from Ur to Canaan. That's how you demonstrate your faith. These folks were demonstrating their faith in the land, because remember, that's a big promise God makes to Abraham and his family, gonna give you a land. They're demonstrating their faith in the land by following these laws. And of course, the big Ten Commandments, right, kind of summarize all those laws. What are the promises of the Mosaic Covenant? Well, we actually just read them right out of the gate when we began today, when we looked at Deuteronomy 28, because we read about the particulars of the Mosaic covenant when it's established in Exodus 24 and then it's reiterated in that passage I shared with you out of Deuteronomy 28. One of the things you need to understand about the promises of the Mosaic covenant are that they are all tied to living in the land that God promised to his people. And we saw some of those particulars. We'll look at them again. But God promised blessing for obedience to the law through material abundance in the land. Remember that he'd make their crops grow and their cows have lots of other cows and their families get big. And so if they obeyed, God would bless them with abundance. If they disobeyed, well, God would punish them with famine and lack. And we'll see that in a moment as well. And that ultimately, if they completely abandoned the covenant that God made with them through Moses, God would remove them from the land. That was like the ultimate punishment for them. Why? Because all of the blessing that they could enjoy had to be enjoyed in the land. Now, remember, I promised that if you just hang with me a moment, that everything's going to make a lot of sense. Let's go back now to Deuteronomy 28 for just a few moments so I can show you something. Deuteronomy 28, where we have the Mosaic covenant stated again. And I just read a few verses. I'll hit those again, and then I'll jump down and show you something else. This is the Mosaic covenant restated. God speaking through Moses. And if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all of his commandments that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Right? So he's talking to the people of Israel and God. Those are the parties. The terms are you got to obey these laws. And if you do, verse 3, blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground and the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your herds and the young of your flock. He's talking about giving them more and more good stuff. Verse 5, blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Have lots of bread to eat. Blessed shall you be when you come in and blessed shall you be when you go out. That's the promise. Between God and Israel, if you obey these laws, I'll give you all of these things. If you don't obey these laws, now verse 15 comes into play here. But if you will not obey the voice of the Lord your God or be careful to do all his commandments and his statutes that I command you today, then all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. Same lesson, same language even, just the flip side. Cursed shall you be in the city, and cursed shall you be in the field. Cursed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Cursed shall be the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground, the increase of your herds and the young of your flock. Cursed shall you be when you come in, and cursed shall you be when you go out. Israel, if you follow these laws, I will give you so many cows, lots of bread, barbecue every weekend. It's going to be fantastic. If you don't, you're going to struggle in the land. You're not going to have enough to eat. And we see that. We see that God allows foreign armies throughout the course of Israel's history to come in and chastise them when they wander far from his covenant. And so these promises of physical abundance that we've looked at that confuse us sometimes when we wonder why God isn't taking care of our land, so to speak. Well, these are promises that are a part of the Mosaic covenant. Therefore, the people of Israel, and this is where the confusion comes from that I think a lot of people experience, a lot of the confusion that I'm seeing, like I said, on social media or when I talk to my friends. God is not lying about promises of physical abundance for faithful followers. He's not lying about that. It's just that these Old Testament promises are not for us. They're not for followers of Jesus, right? Because we're not a part of the Mosaic covenant. To participate in those promises, we would have to, you know, transport ourselves back in time and be under the law, but we're not under law anymore. If you've read your New Testament, you know this. We're not under law. we're under grace. To participate in these promises, we would have to keep those terms. It's impossible for us to do that because none of us are time travelers, at least as far as I know. Maybe some of you are. The thing is, we are not under the Mosaic covenant. We are under a better covenant with God. We have a better relationship with him because of Jesus. In fact, we're under what the New Testament calls the New Covenant. Let me just show you a couple of passages that explain this a little bit. 1 Corinthians, let's go to our New Testaments now. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And this verse is going to sound very familiar to you if you've ever been at a church communion service because it's often read. But it says something about this special relationship that we have with Jesus when it was established and the fact that we are experiencing it now. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Corinthian believers, says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Paul is talking about the Last Supper with Jesus and his disciples on the night before his arrest. And we see in that event, Jesus establishing a new covenant with us. The Mosaic covenant was established with sacrifices and blood was scattered on the people. Here, Jesus is saying this bread, this wine, these are the elements of this new covenant. My body will be broken, my blood will be shed, and we are in now a new covenant. The author of Hebrews has some things to say about this new covenant that we are experiencing. Hebrews chapter 8, verses 6 through 13, very quickly, the author says this about our new covenant. But as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates, the new covenant, is better. Do you hear what he just said? Our covenant, the new covenant, is better than the old covenant. Why? Since it is enacted on better promises. We have better promises than they had under the Mosaic covenant. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion to look for a second. In other words, if it was so great to be in the Mosaic covenant, why should there be a new one? For he finds fault with them when he says, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will establish a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. And of course, the church participates in this new covenant as well. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. For they did not continue in my covenant, so I showed no concern for them, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds and write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will be merciful toward their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. Now the author of Hebrews again says this, in speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. It's obsolete. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. I read that because I want you to see some things. You and I are not in the old covenant, and it's better that we're not. We are in a new covenant with Jesus. And like the covenant with Abraham, and the covenant with Moses, this new covenant has those three elements as well. The parties of this new covenant are Jesus and you and me. Anybody who believes in him, anybody who claims him as Lord, we're in this new special relationship with him. The terms of that covenant are that we need to trust in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Trust that he is who he said he is, that he is God, the Son, incarnated in flesh, and trust that his work on the cross pays the price for for our sins. So the parties are us and Jesus. The terms, we just have to trust in him. What are the promises? Because the author of Hebrews talks about how much better our promises are. Our promises are tied to the kingdom of God, not a specific geographical location, not the land. You see the difference between the old covenant and the new. Our promises are tied to the eternal kingdom of God, not just a piece of land. And amongst our promises are eternal salvation. That's better than lots of cows and bread. We're promised the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. That's better than any material thing that we could ever desire. We're promised inclusion in the fellowship of the believers, the church. That's us. And we're promised participation in God's kingdom work. Remember, this covenant is all about keeping that promise to Abraham that through him, all the families of the world would be blessed. That's through the ministry of Jesus as we continue it as well. And so we New Testament believers are in a better covenant. Our covenant is better than the old Mosaic covenant because the promises we benefit from are spiritual and not just material. You see, material things don't last, but the promises God has made to us will last forever. Our promises are not tied to living in the promised land because those of us who call Jesus Lord live all over this planet, right? So our promises are tied to God's eternal kingdom. Our covenant promises guarantee eternal salvation, not just temporary material blessings. And all of those things are better. Even though we still might want lots of stuff, think, it'd be great to have lots of cows and bread. The author of Hebrews wants us to understand that these lasting blessings, these eternal blessings, are far superior to what God promised in the Mosaic covenant. So what? What's our takeaway from all of this? Because you could look at what I've just told you and said, well, he gave us kind of a historical, theological glance at the Bible. Yeah, but there are some important implications of what I've shared with you today. I've shown you the framework, the scaffolding underneath God's plan for human history. We saw that in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, that contains the outline for the whole Bible. The rest of Scripture is God keeping those three promises to Abraham. We saw how the people of Israel participated in the land promise, and now we are participating in the blessing promise, that being able to participate in blessing the world through the ministry and work of Jesus. And so I guess here's the takeaway that I'd like to give you as we wrap up this time today. Don't be confused if God doesn't bless you with material prosperity. I've been joking around about cows and land and bread and all that kind of stuff, but a lot of times when we find ourselves struggling financially, we ask God to help us out of it. Maybe for some reason God chooses not to. We think that God's disciplining us. Believer, your promises from the Lord are not material. They're spiritual. He's blessed you with spiritual blessings. And so if God doesn't make you rich and happy and healthy and all those kinds of things that some preachers say real Christians get to enjoy, understand, those guys are wrong. We have a better covenant with the Lord through Jesus. So don't be confused if God doesn't bless you with material blessings. It's not that he's mad at you. Those promises were for a different time. Don't be confused if God allows you to experience trials. It's not punishment. You still possess his promises, even though you're struggling through difficult times. Jesus promises us that we will struggle, that we will have troubles in this life. Remember that? He says that. Not to worry about that, though, because he's overcome the world. The bottom line is this: you are in a special relationship with God right now. You are the recipient of promises right now that you will hold on to forever into eternity. That's better than the Mosaic covenant. That's a lasting, eternal covenant. I wanted to lay this groundwork with you today because next week, what I want us to do is actually look at some specific Old Testament promises that trip people up. And I want us to try to understand them under the guidance of this framework that we've laid. We'll see that the Old Testament has value for us. There's no doubt about it. You and I, as Christians, need to cherish the Old Testament. But we'll learn next week to look for principles behind the promises that God made to the Old Testament believers. I'm looking forward to that time. I'll see you next week. God bless you.